the love of God. But the remarkable thing is that nothing can come between the love of God and a saint. The things Paul mentioned in this passage can, if you disrupt the close fellowship of our soul with God and separate our natural life from Him. But none of them is able to come between the God, the love of God, and the soul of a saint and the spiritual love. The underlying foundation of the Christian faith is the undeserved, limitless miracle of the love of God that was exhibited on the cross of Calvary. A love that is not earned and can never be. Paul says this is the reason that in all things we are more than conquerors. We are super victims for the joy that comes from experiencing the very things which look as if they are going to overwhelm us. And this is what the illustration gives that really makes sense. Even twigs that look frightened and ordinary swing produce a tremendous thrill for the surface. Just think about that for a little bit. Even when I love the ocean, and I have no fear of swimming, but I can tell you I've been humbled a time or two. And take the feel about this big when you're crawling up off the beach on your hands and knees. You make sure you realize how deep you really are. The ordinary swim is a tremendous thrill for the surfer who has ridden them. Let's apply that to our own circumstances, the things we try to avoid in fighting tribulation, suffering, and persecution are the very things that produce abundant joy. We are more than conquerors through Him. And all these things, not in spite of them, but in the midst of them, a saint doesn't notice the joy of the Lord in spite of tribulation, but because of it. Paul says, I am exceedingly joyful in all our tribulations. 2 Corinthians 7:4. The undiminished radiance, which is the result of abundant joy, is not built on anything past, but on the love of God that nothing can change. In the experiences of life, whether they are everyday events or terrifying moments, are powerless to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Romans 8:39. And then it's got a little thing at the bottom called wisdom from Oswald Chambers. Always keep in contact with those books and those people that enlarge your horizon and make it possible for you to stretch yourself mentally. I was thinking about that illustration, the surfing illustration. And I couldn't believe that. Wow. It really made me stop and think how true that is. And I've never served a majority of the time or really opportunity to. But I started skiing when I was 11 or 12 years old. And the first time I ever skied, it wasn't a joke that I skied down. But it was thrilling. And at the same time, but now, if I could see that same town, I could probably do it with my eyes closed, and it would have absolutely no fun in it at all. And that's because I kept pushing. I started on a small hill, and I kept pushing and pushing, getting to a bigger hill, a steeper hill, and a steeper hill, and a taller hill. And after a few years, that entire place that I used to ski as a kid, the whole place was boring to me. I wasn't even fun to go to anymore. It was like, I could see the hardest hill they have all night long. It's like, why am I spending the money to do this? It's not fun anymore. But the difference is between that and the surfing illustration, which applies very well to life, is waves break in a very specific area. You've never been to the beach. You say you can sit just enough on shore where the water, when it breaks, just comes up to you. It has no effect on you. Or you can sit far enough out where the wind doesn't break. It's just like just rolling. You can just kind of ride up and down, and that's nice too. And you can ask fishing. This is how I live my life. I just stick to the edge of the beach, let the water hit me. Or I can come up fast enough past the break. Where it's just nice to do. I'm happy. That's what I do. I'm not going to lie. I'm not going to think I'm something I'm not. And I never really thought about it until I read this Wednesday morning. I thought, I'm just kind of punching things out. I'm like, you know, just passed for the great spring. I can tell you, if you're not ready for it, it's going to give you a run. Some of you might enjoy the run. Some of you might not enjoy the run. But it's the same in life. If you live your life and you're trying to swim out past the current, or trying to swim in the shore constantly, every once in a while, you get caught right in the middle. Now, some people, those who live what this verse is talking about, they live in the knowledge that nothing can separate them from the love of God. You know where they hang out? When they're waiting for it. Now, I have another day of the year. I'm going to go for a walking advertisement for these little kids. It's probably just my attention span is a little bit short. I can do something in a minute to get done on it. There was a story. Now, this goes to where sometimes you get caught. There was a story on my particular day of the year. I couldn't remember the date. But it's of a man. He's a husband and a father. And he loses his wife. And I think he loses some other children. And he's left just with him. A little baby son, a young little boy. And he becomes very discouraged and very depressed for obvious reasons. And one day he takes the son to the doctor. And he's got to get a shot. And there are plenty of people who want to get shot, including little boys. And he takes, he's holding his son there, and his son looks up to him. He's crying, and he's asking him, you know, like, why? You know, why, Dad? Why, Dad? It hurts. Why? And suddenly, the thought pops into his head. I'm doing the same thing. I've been asking God, why? Why? He couldn't explain to that little boy, look, you need this shot. It's important for your health. Because the little boy here is the one he trusts. He depends on for everything, allowing him to go through pain. Why? Why would he do that? And it was like a joke to his whole being to realize, wait a minute. All along, God's been telling me, I know it hurts, but it's for you. It's for you. And suddenly the light bulb pops on, you realize, God doesn't just arbitrarily allow you to go through tribulation and trials and heartache and suffering. It's not just random. Every one of us, God has every one of our lives planned out. He knows every moment of every day. There is nothing that just happens by surprise to God. Now, yes, we all get surprised. But not God. And suddenly you realize, I've been doing that this whole time. I was so focused on the why are you letting me be in such pain? Why are you allowing me to endure such loss? And the whole time God's been trying to tell me, it's for your good. It's for your good. Now, how does a man like that, who lost so much, how can he possibly know it's for his good? Because of this little portion of scripture. Because if you love someone, you won't allow them to go through pain unless it's for their good. When you love someone, you don't just hurt them just for the sake of hurting them. And God's love for us is way beyond any love you can have, whether it's for a spouse, a friend, or even a son or a daughter. It's far beyond any of them. So if you think God would just arbitrarily allow you to go through suffering, now, I'll be honest with you, it's probably not the best thing to speak out from the pulpit because I'm like setting myself up for something bad. But that's how it is. And I can say that whenever I have thoughts for ministry, It's usually because God's trying to tell me, and that you have some stuff that needs to work on. So, obviously, I'm going to work on this. So, that's an illustration for, some ways that just get up and fight the process. But, the other thing I was thinking of, and how I said, you have some Christians who can win into the break, and they stay in, and they find a comfort almost in that situation where they're always living. And a simple illustration I have for that is, I know a couple who I've been very good friends with for a long time. And one day I was with another friend, and his father just happened to be a preacher, and we were talking, and the conversation came up about this couple, and I just mentioned about how sometimes I think he spends too much time at work. He works too much. And he told me, he said that's his gift. And I'm like, he said, man, if I told you how much they have given to preachers, to the work, to people who are in need, he said, wouldn't believe it. He said, wouldn't believe it. I said, I've been thinking about that, and I can tell you that this man definitely loves his job. I'm not sure if he's sober, so he's excited, to be honest with you. But I can tell you he loves his job, and he was very good at it. And if I had been the owner of the company he worked for, I would have done. He would stand up there and tell you today that the success of his company was a large part of his business. And you say, well, especially those who have to work full-time. Our job shouldn't be drudgery, because some jobs just don't. I'm not going to lie, every Sunday, I'm not going to work. So we should look at it as an opportunity to honor God. And that's what this man, that's how this man conducted himself. And God blessed him for it. And the thought struck me about people who are willing to live in the truth of God's love for them, that how many Christians come to church on a Sunday and you don't really notice them a whole lot? And it doesn't really seem like they bring a whole lot of honor and glory to God. They're kind of quiet. Maybe some of them, don't have a real gift. And they leave here, and everything they do, from the time they leave here to the time they come back, brings honor and glory to God. And how many people who have gifts and get up, and everything they do only brings honor and glory to themselves? And yet, they get the honor and glory, and they're like, wow, many of them get it. And meanwhile, they're still pumping themselves up for them. And it just struck me that, it's easy to make excuses. Well, I'm not good at this, or I'm not good at that. And the thought for me, kind of strikes me that no matter what I do on a daily basis, I can honor and glorify God so long as I live what I believe. So long as I go throughout the day, understanding that it's not under my own power, it's not under my own ability, my own skill, share with my own knowledge, but it's only under His blessing and His guidance and His leading. Because, you know, you venture out in the day, and sometimes, you know, you think you've got it all figured out for that day, and you've got it all handled. And then you get out there, and it all just falls apart on you. And then there's some days where, you know, you're dreading that day. Leave in God's hands, and it turns out great. So, like I said, it was kind of simple and unorganized, to say the least. But I just want to encourage you to live what you believe. When you go out there today, remember that God loves us, and there's nothing, there is absolutely nothing that's going to change that. Or separate us from His love. And that no matter what we may encounter, what we may endure throughout the day, that ultimately it is for our good. It is for His honor and His glory. You know, it's very easy to look right now out in the world and completely discouraged and just, you know, want to close your door and not want that. But what kind of honor and glory would we bring to God if we just, you know, end up out all day long? Right? So, I hope you found some encouragement about sort of just bringing down the thought. But remember that nothing is separated from the love of God.
Good morning, everyone. I do have to say that any words that the last ministry will probably be anticlimactic. And we do thank Matt for his excellent ministry. And Matt ministered to us from Romans 8. And he also showed results, gave some examples of the results of that ministry, what it's been doing to us. So it's kind of interesting that I would like to speak a little bit about ministry this morning, and we'll read some verses from God's perspective. I was going to start my message by saying, what are you all sitting here for? And you remember how the Lord upbraided the crowd, where in Matthew 11, don't turn to it, but anyway, He was talking about John the Baptist. What did you come out to see? What did you come out to see? What did you come out to hear? And someone like that. And what are you doing sitting there? And of course, my stomach says, well, I'm waiting until lunch is prepared. But hopefully along the way, we can get some words of ministry here from God. And certainly we're not also like those in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 3, that just had itching ears. So they weren't a subject to sort of placate their emotions, if you will, just to say, oh, okay, everything's hunky-dory, there's no problem with us. But wouldn't you receive sound godly doctrine, of course, that can be some cutting to the quick, if you will, which is good for us, too. So I'm going to talk some this morning about ministry, both oral, formal ministry, and also ministry of us to others that we can perform on a one-on-one basis. And I can remember back in the springtime of 2010, I'd been busy traveling, and I was sort of in the doldrums, if you will. The vibrancy of being a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ was not there in my personal life. Yes, I could read scripture. I saw black print on white pages. And yes, I could even see how some verses strung together. But the freshness, the vitalness of this relationship of the Lord was missing. Again, I mentioned a little bit about that. So I went to a Bible conference to get some good ministry. And I needed to snap out of it. I needed a thus saith the Lord. I needed the right verse at the right time to snap me out of it. And I was very disappointed. The first person that got up and spoke and ministered, if you will, gave some of the old assembly stick, like whatever it's called, if you will. And he had his points 4 or 5 or 6 and something like that. And said, you do this, you do that, and yada, yada, yada. But it did not minister to me at all. But fortunately, others did bring forth the Word of God in an essential manner. And I did most definitely feel much more appreciative of the work of the Lord for me. And I was more appreciative of the true grace of God in which we stand. With regard to heart ministry, I can also remember one fellow, and he only spoke on 2 verses in Psalms. And this is sort of a dual aspect ministry message, if you will. And it was like I was an onion, and I was sitting in the audience, and he would pull off layer after layer after layer until I was essentially there. Totally exposed. And, you know, that reminded me then of my position in Christ. He pulled off all of the gobbledygook that was upsetting me, disturbing me, and everything like that, so that I was just before the Lord. And then, of course, the minister then talked about the true grace of God, where in which we stand. And I went away, indeed, rejoicing in the Lord and of his completed work. With regard to minister or ministry, there's some words in the Greek, and you can think of them. English translates a whole mess of words to minister or ministry. Diakonos is a servant, an attendant, a minister, a deacon. Huperakes is an under-rower, if you will. And I mentioned earlier about an under-rower. And that's a seaman subordinate that's acting under another's direction. So that's like the Lord saying, go here, do this, and so on like that. And there are other Greek synonyms, such as doulos, which is a bond servant, and so on like that. With regard to verbs, there are about 6 Greek words that are verbs with regard to minister. And but generally, it just means to serve, to take care of, to meet another person's needs, and things like that. And with regard to public oral ministry, one might ask, what are some of God's principles of ministry? And we can find them in 4 places in the New Testament. And I will go to 1 Corinthians 12, 13, 14. We'll read some verses out of that. We'll go to Ephesians 4 and also Romans 5. But real quickly here, I'd just like to read some verses out of 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And this was in regard to spiritual gifts. And it says, now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant. And then we skip down to verses 4 to 11, and we'll read those there. Now, there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit, and there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord, and there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which worketh all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit withal. For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another the gift of healings by the same Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another diverse kinds of tongues, and to another the interpretation of tongues. But all these worketh that one and the self-same Spirit dividing to every man severally as he will. See, here we see what the Spirit of God has given to the church, if you will. And that's interesting. All of this spiritual gift, if you will. Every one of us has a gift, and the idea is that the gift should be used, of course, for the benefit of others, to minister to others, and indeed to the assembly. And then there's truth about the body and diversity of the members and how we all need each other to function. And verses 27 and 28 say this. Now ye are the body of Christ, and members in one particular, and God has set some in the church, first apostles, secondarily prophets, thirdly teachers, and after that miracles and gifts of healing, health, government, diversity of tongues. And of course it's for, if you will, the building up of the assembly. In chapter 13, which is the great love chapter, it says that all these gifts that one might have matter nothing if they are not, of course, governed by love. And I found that very, very interesting. You can read in chapter 13, the first three verses. So I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, and have not charity. I have become a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have a gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith, so that I could remove mountains, and have not charity, I have nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, and have not charity, it profiteth nothing. So, of course, any kind of gift that we have is governed by love. It should always be done in love. It should always be to the furtherance of, if you will, building people up, encourage them, and so on like that, in the things of the Lord, and to help care for their needs, spiritually and then, of course, materially, too, in the church. Chapter 14 deals specifically with the gift of speaking, and that would be like conveying God's thoughts. And of course, we know that prophecy that's spoken up here in the Old Testament, in the early part of the New Testament. Of course, there are people that could prophesy and tell forth the teachings of prophecy here. It has to do with speaking God's thoughts from His Word to those in the audience to convey spiritual things to those in the audience. And it's the sense of getting God's take and understanding and comprehension of anything and bringing it down to our level where we can comprehend things. And, of course, take heed and have some attitude adjustments along the way. And there are some rules there with regard to such oral ministry. I find in verse 29. And it says, let the prophet speak two or three, and let the others judge. And that night, because there will be two this morning. And then we can read earlier in chapter 14, what the spoken ministry should do. And verse 3 says, but he that prophesies speaketh unto men to edification and exhortation and comfort. Edification, the root word, Greek word, is okedone. And Paul should be familiar with that. It has to do with building or construction. That's the root word. But it essentially means to build up, to edify, to strengthen, to develop another person's life through acts of love and encouragement. I found that interesting. And then exhortation. What about exhortation there? Well, the Greek word is paraklesis, and that's a double word. I think para might mean to come alongside of, and klesis would be to call. So it means to call a person, if you will, alongside you, for encouragement, comfort, consolation, and appeal. And what about the word comfort in the Greek? Well, that is paramuthia, and it means to speak closely to anyone near. And it sort of denotes consolation, comfort, but it's with a greater degree of tenderness than just plain exhortation. It's been said, and again, I will attribute this to a book that I happen to find, that's been said by another, that edification is for the mind, the rational part of a believer. Exhortation is for the conscience of a believer, important part. And comfort, or I should say, comfort is for the heart. So the first will build up in the art of right thinking. The second will stir us up in the art of right acting. And the third will bind up the wounds of the discouraged and brokenhearted and then restore them to brightness. And then there is Romans chapter 5. Let me go go there with regard to the target of ministry and what God has done. In Romans chapter 5, and we'll read verses 5 through 8. Romans chapter 5, 5 through 8. Here we are. So we being many, that's the church, comprised of members, one body in Christ, and every member one of another. Having then gifts, different according to the grace that is given to us, whether prophecy, let us prophesy according to the proportion of faith, or ministry, let us wait on our ministering, or he that teaches on teaching, or he that exhorteth on exhortation, he that giveth, let him do it with simplicity, he that ruleth with diligence, he that showeth mercy with cheerfulness. And then going down to verses 9 and 10, it says, let love be without, there's that word again that we saw in 1 Corinthians 13, let love be without hypocrisy, abhor that which is evil, cleave to that which is good, be kindly affectioned one to another. Brotherly love, with brotherly love, in honor preferring one another. And that's one of the hallmarks in Jesus to be our fellow believers and indeed to love them, even as Christ loved the church. So that's one of the interesting overlying themes with regard to ministry and the result of it. We are to be kindly affectioned one with brotherly love in honor preferring one another. And finally, Ephesians chapter 4, verses 11 through 16. And here, of course, we see that God gave men to the church, people with specific gifts and abilities, and he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. Why? Verse 12 says, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, under the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive. But speaking the truth in love, that's that word love again, may grow up into him in all things which is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which is which every joint supplieth according to the effectual working and the measure of every part, maketh increase of the body unto the edifying of itself. And so with regard to God's principles for ministry, for spoken ministry, it should be for the perfecting of the saints. And it's interesting that the word perfecting means to render fit or complete. And since we are all different, it's kind of unique. It does take and require a variety of different physical ministers, if you will, that can connect with and that can teach God's people. And of course, there could be a teaching ministry to help equip the saints. And the thing is that oral ministries to equip each believer so that we can then go out and help our fellow believers and indeed meet the needs of fellow saints in love. It's interesting, again, the uniqueness of personalities is that we all do not communicate well with each other, and so it takes all of us indeed to be ministers of each other. And all ministry is to the exercise of promoting the growth of the body of Christ unto unity and the maturity and the conformity to the spiritual things of God. And the end result should be that we would be no more behaving as children. We should not be taught to and fro. And we won't be gullible as to the sleight of man trying to deceive us to the cunning of craftiness. And the ultimate goal is that we would be a harmonious working together church. And Ephesians chapter 14 through 15, and the ESV says, rather speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into him who is the head, unto Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and held together by every joint with which it is equipped, when each part is working properly, makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. And that's that word again. So that's some of what the spoken word of ministry should do, to help us, mobilize us, if you will, get us utilizing our spiritual gift for the welfare of our fellow believers, so that we can be ministering to others. So if you see a need, if you see your fellow person, fellow believer, someone sad, go and put your arm around them and ask them, can I help you? What's going on here? Things like that. So if you see the need, please do it. And only God made you the unique person that you are and like I am. And yes, I have been before the Lord in prayer asking him why he made me like he did. Because I can see other people do great things that I cannot even begin to do. But anyway, we do struggle in some things. But that's why there's a diversity of personalities. That's why there's a diversity of gifts in the body of Christ. And finally, Galatians 5:13 says, for brethren, ye have been called unto liberty, but do not use not liberty for an occasion to the flesh, but by love serve one another. And Philippians 2:3 says, let nothing be done through strife or vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than themselves. And indeed, that's how the church should be growing, and that's how we should be behaving in the world, and that should be the result, if you will, of total ministry to some extent. So, let's close in prayer. Our Father, we would thank you for the topic of ministry. We thank you that we've had less than a word here. We thank you that we can be. We go to Rowan Faith and see your great love with which we are loved, and that nothing can indeed separate us from the love of Christ. Thank you for the goodly going forth of the gospel message this morning. And we pray for those in the audience, those in need of salvation, might indeed take it to heart. We pray for the salvation of precious souls. We pray for the Sunday school here to finish it up, and we give the text now concluded. And we pray thy blessing upon her, and thank you for the wonderful blessing, especially for thy son and my son, this name we pray.